Lorraine Dastin was educated at Harvard and Cambridge Universities, and she has taught at Columbia, Harvard, Princeton, Brandeis, the University of Göttingen, and the University of Chicago. She has also held visiting positions at the École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales in Paris, the University of Vienna, Oxford University, Harvard University, and the University of Chicago. Since 1995, Dr. Dastin has been director of the Max Planck Institute for the History of Science and honorary professor at the Humboldt University, both in Berlin. Her edited volumes include biographies of scientific objects and things that talk. Her other books include, among others, Classical Probability and the Enlightenment, and with Catherine Park, Wonders and the Order of Nature, both of which were awarded the Feitzer Prize of the History of Science Society. Objectivity will be published by Zone Books later this year. The title of Dr. Dastin's talk this evening is Norms from Nature, and I have the sense that it's going to come from a very antithetical perspective from Dr. Edelman, so this will make for a very nice compliment.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. I don't know whether the perspective will be antithetical to Dr. Edelman's, but it draws upon, for its empirical material, not Dernier-Cli neuroscience, but rather upon a very long history, both scientific and philosophical, of thoughts about nature. I must say it's an act of great self-restraint not to pelt Dr. Edelman with questions now after his tantalizing lecture, but all of us, I'm afraid, will have to bear with me for a little longer. The puzzle that I want to address is a very simple one. After many years as a historian of science, sighing with exasperation as I read one foiled attempt after another to extract social and moral norms from nature, I finally decided it might be a good idea not to inquire how best to explain why this is a doomed idea, but rather to try and understand why it is so persistent, why it is almost irresistible to try to extract moral norms from the world of nature. And this lecture is one long thought experiment fortified with, as I said, historical examples as to why we find it so difficult not to extract norms from nature. Of all the nightmares that bedevil the collective human imagination, that of chaos is the most terrifying. Human history is stained with orders that have been bloody, tyrannical, and ruthless, orders that have suffocated like an iron vice. And many philosophers and scientists have judged the order of nature to be heartless, inexorable in its workings, and indifferent to human joys and sorrows. Order itself can become a nightmare. But the horrors of excessive order pale beside those aroused by no order at all. Civil war is a greater calamity than the most oppressive dictatorship. A universe formless and lawless is the ground zero for all cosmogonies, be it divinity or natural law, that's called upon to create a cosmos worthy of the name. A land in which no promises are kept, in which the sun may or may not rise tomorrow, in which the past is no guide to the future, is a no man's land. Nothing human, indeed, nothing living, can long survive in an environment which is wholly at the mercy of chance. This nightmarish thought experiment conflates natural and social orders in a way that will, I'm sure, raise eyebrows. It's intended to. Though few may doubt that natural and social chaos are each, in its own way, horrific, many will query the equation of the two, and still more, the identification of the two orders, chaos annihilates. It's an axiom of modern thought that nature and society are distinct realms. The argument runs something like this, and I'll go through this rather quickly because I think it will be familiar to all of you. Both nature and society may be ruled by an order, but the kinds of order to which each is subject are categorically different. The side of nature is universal, eternal, invariable. The only violation of natural laws are miracles, and in order to have a miracle, even those who countenance such interventions have to appeal to something outside of nature, the supernatural, literally above nature. In contrast, as we all know, human laws are violated, alas, all too often without any divine intervention. We also know that human societies are famously variable, both historically and cross-culturally. We might want to draw analogies between the two realms. Natural law is, of course, one such famous analogy. But now, continuing with this argument, these are merely metaphors. And moreover, these metaphors are not innocent. They can be quite dangerous, runs the argument. To describe the natural order in terms of the social order commits the intellectual crime of anthropomorphism, that is, of projecting human categories onto the non-human world. And to describe the social order in terms of the natural order is to commit the naturalistic fallacy, that is, to assume that human norms can be buttressed by natural regularities. Even if human beings and all their works are, as material objects, subject to natural laws, continuing with this argument, nature has no power to convert an is into an ought. Yet, all social orders are built upon the normative foundations of ought. They are moral orders of what should be, not just what happens to be the case. So, appeals to the moral authority of nature, so this argument concludes, commit a fallacy, namely, the doomed attempt to shore up contingent social norms with natural necessities. Therefore, the kind of thought experiment I performed at the outset, in which I deliberately conflated natural and social chaos, will make many very uncomfortable on these grounds. Yet even those who defend a hard and fast boundary between the natural and the moral orders would be the first to admit that trespassing is rife. Despite the best efforts of some of the best philosophers since at least the 17th century to police the border, people constantly talk about nature in social terms and they talk about society in natural terms. Even biologists and physicists, at least when the doors are closed and they're all alone, talk unselfconsciously about the desires of electrons and the intentions of genes. The annals of social history, the history of social theory, are littered with attempts to extract some kind of politics from beehives, from the physics of levers, or evolutionary theory. There doesn't seem to be any amount of earnest and well-reasoned argument, and believe me, there's been a lot, that seems sufficient either to root out anthropomorphism or the naturalistic fallacy. And I'm certainly under no illusions that I'm going to succeed where the likes of David Hume and Immanuel Kant and John Stuart Mill have failed. So the object of my inquiry is rather just the bare fact of the persistence of these conceptual errors, if errors they be. Why is the temptation to merge natural and social orders apparently so absolutely irresistible? And I'd like to try and suggest in the course of this talk an answer to that question. I'm going to try, therefore, to reopen the question of norms in nature. My argument's going to be both historical and philosophical. So historically, I'll try to show how various conceptions of natural order have sustained not only specific norms, both moral and aesthetics, but have moreover served as a model for what any kind of norm can be. So that's the empirical part. The philosophical part is that appeals to nature, though often, and also, in my opinion, I should say, rightly criticized, nonetheless do capture something profound about values in general, regardless of their specific content. So that this argument is going to hinge on the connection between normativity, a word I'll explain in a moment, and order. I'm going to conclude that we can't do without nature. Even if we divest nature of all divine authority whatsoever, so this is not an argument that has a theological dimension, the human impulse to make nature meaningful is not just a psychological failing. It is an epistemological and an ethical necessity, at least for the kind of creatures that we are. So I'm going to try and give you two historical examples. This by no means exhausts the rich thesaurus of attempts, even within the narrow Western tradition, to try and extract norms from nature. And I apologize for my own limitations. My examples will be drawn from the Western tradition. This is simply because of the fact that, to my shame, I do not know, for example, Chinese, Japanese, or Sanskrit. But I have looked at the secondary sources, and I think there is, at least very cautiously, some grounds for a broader generalization. The attempts of intellectuals in the Western tradition to extract norms from nature stretch back to Greek and Roman antiquity, and they're still ongoing. It's important to realize that over the millennia, attempts to extract norms from nature have served the cause of both the political right and the political left. There have been revolutions which have called nature to the barricades, and there have been reactionaries who have enlisted nature in their cause. There's nothing intrinsically liberal or conservative about the enlistment of nature into a moral or a political cause, and that will be later part of my argument. It would take many volumes yet to be written to do justice to this very long and motley history of invoking nature to buttress human values of the true, the good, and the beautiful. Here, I'm only going to describe only two such episodes, which I've chosen both because of their broad and durable influence, and also because one of these arguments is purely philosophical, and the other is purely, or mostly, theological. I just want to show you that it can work both ways. Although nature's normative authority has, particularly in the Latin Christian tradition, often been grounded in divine dictates, by no means all appeals to nature's authority are religious. So the first example is what I'll call nature as justice, and I'll be calling as my primary witnesses, simply because they're amongst the best known, Plato and Aristotle. And the second will be about nature as the will of God, calling mostly on Augustine. And I'm not going to endorse either of these. In fact, I think both of them are really quite dubious. My interest here is in figuring out how such attempts work and why their hold on our imagination is so tenacious. So my argument is first empirical. I want to give you some stuff to think about. And second, explanatory. I want to give you reasons for why this happens. So first, nature as justice. Like any truly interesting word, nature is a millefeuille of layered meanings. And in order to understand how nature could yield an ideal of justice into political philosophy, we have to recall that the most venerable definition of nature, at least in Greek and Latin, is of something you might call specific nature. So it's not nature, the entire universe. It's that which makes a particular thing what it is. It's ontological identity card, if you will. And this is the thing which makes a squirrel, a squirrel, a rose, a rose, an eagle, an eagle. You can imagine, in some kind of great chain of being, a hierarchy of these beings, but each one is still the thing it is. So the hierarchy, you might run from a rock to the deities, but it's important within this great scale of being that each rung remains stable. So the rose does not aspire to become a squirrel. There's no social mobility in the great chain of being. Now, it's this idea of fixed natural kinds that provides the inspiration for a certain ideal of justice. It's closely related to the idea of organic specialization. And remember that the word organ comes from the Greek organon, and it means literally tool, so it's the most artificial of all artifacts. And Aristotle, for example, uses the term indifferently to refer either to a human tool or to an organ in the sense of bodily organ, functional parts of living beings. And for Aristotle, nature and art exemplify the same kind of workmanship. Aristotle says, look, if nature was going to make boats, she doesn't have them to make boats, but if nature were going to make boats, nature would make them the same way that shipwrights do. Moreover, the highest standards of workmanship, either human or natural, require that each tool, each organ, be only fitted to one purpose. I'll just read you a quotation from Aristotle. And this is one reason why he thinks that nature's handiwork is superior. For nature makes nothing as the cutlers make the Delphic knife on the cheap, but one thing for one purpose, so that each tool will be turned out in the finest perfection if it serves not many uses but one. So I have no idea what a Delphic knife is, but I think the Delphic knife must have been the ancient equivalent of the Swiss Army knife, which had all different kinds of purposes, which Aristotle finds an infringement upon the principles of good workmanship. Now, it's this idea of an organic order which is based upon extreme specialization and which lies at the heart of Plato's utopia in The Republic. It's founded on the principle that each citizen plies only the trade or function for which he or she is fitted by nature, kataphusin. Injustice is defined as the violation of specialization, either when citizens interchange their tools and their honors, or when the same man undertakes all these functions at once. Now, this is an order of nature, according to Plato, but it's not immutable. So it's an order of nature quite unlike our idea of nature, which is inviolable without exception. Plato thinks that this order is so fragile that he doesn't want the ruling class, the guardians, to be allowed to take part in plays where they might denature themselves, as he says, by even acting the part of some other social class. So precarious is this order, although it is a natural order. So just as you can dull a knife edge by using it as a screwdriver, you could take the edge off a guardian by having him or her play, even briefly, a part of one of the lower orders. I take Plato's Republic to illustrate an organic order because it's among the most detailed and influential examples, not because it's unique. And you might think, just to refresh your memory, there is a very long and dense history in medieval Latin political theory of the body politic, in which the three orders of society, the aristocracy, the clergy, and everybody else, the rest of us, are represented respectively by the heart, the aristocracy, the head, the clergy, and the hands and feet, which are the commoners who do all the work. The point of all of this is that although there's a hierarchy of value, it's obviously better to be a member of the aristocracy than to be a member of a commoner, all these parts are necessary. If a body politic had two hearts or two heads and no hands and feet, it would be in a parlous situation. So the artisans in Plato's Republic are no less necessary, if less noble, than the guardians. It need hardly be pointed out that these kinds of moral orders based upon specific natural kinds are mostly, although not unexceptionably, conservative. They're hostile to social mobility in any directions and to liberal principles of individual equality and autonomy. But they're not conservative in quite the same way that post-Enlightenment political and social theories allegedly grounded in nature have been. The moral order of specific natures enjoyed neither the universality nor the inevitability of the historically, much later, orders derived from a metaphysics of natural law. So there's no escape from the dictates of nature in the dictates of social Darwinism, or for that matter, in a novel by Zola or Turgenev. Natural law is inexorable and it is relentless. But there's considerable slippage in the order of natural kind. So Plato admits that sometimes silver parents will have a golden or a brazen child, and Aristotle concedes that some slaves have the rights of free men, or at least the souls of free men, and that some women are more worthy than their husbands, even though they are subordinated to them. These are cases which are contrary to nature, paraphusin, but they're not unnatural in the sense of monsters, or rather, whether they are unnatural in the sense of monsters or marvels is left open, and it's a question which wavers in one direction or another over centuries. There are both negative and positive interpretations of individuals who happen to deviate from their natural kind. And I want to emphasize that there's nothing theological at all about this natural order. It depends in no way whatsoever on calling in the external and higher authority of a deity. Aristotle's nature does not deliberate. Plato's ideal of justice as optimal specialization is not propped up by the gods. Insofar as specific natures wield moral authority, they do so as exemplars of order per se, because before it became mandatory to distinguish whether the order in question was human or natural. Good consists in each being striving to be the best of its kind, not the best of all, and evil in aspiring to the prerogatives of another kind, so that rose that wants to be a squirrel. This order lays no claim to universality, much less to uniformity. On the contrary, it depends on a diversity of types and functions. I'm now going to turn to a much more openly theological view about nature as the will of God. And this, in contrast, makes universality its hallmark. The locus classicus for this tradition is Augustine's Confessions, and especially the passage in which he condemns sodomy as a crime against nature, contra naturam, and therefore against God, whom he calls the author of nature. Now, what he's doing in this passage is he realizes quite contrary to Roman custom, and we have preserved in a proverb what that custom is, namely that when you're in a particular place, you try to adapt to the local folkways, the local ways of doing things, i.e., when in Rome, do as the Romans do. But Augustine queries this long-held platitude in the case of sodomy because he believes it violates divine edict as incorporated in nature. I'll just quote this passage. "For even that society which is betwixt God and us is then violated, when the same nature of which he, God, is the author, is polluted. When God commands anything to be done, either against the customs or constitutions of any people whatsoever, though the like were never done heretofore, yet it is to be done now. For as amongst those powers appointed in human society, the greater authority is set over the lesser to command obedience, so God is set overall," end quote. Natural law, at the time that Augustine is writing, is certainly not a novelty in Roman law. But to grant nature's supreme authority as God's proxy represents a radical break with Republican and early imperial Roman law. For earlier Roman jurists, the category of natural law was indeed universal. It's that which human beings have in common with animals, and it especially applies to what we would call family law and that which regulates reproduction. Unlike civil law, which only extends to a particular political unit, natural law is universal. But that does not mean in Roman jurisprudence prior to Augustine that it therefore trumps civil law. We tend to think that if a law has universal jurisdiction, it ipso facto trumps more local law. That is not the Roman intuition. Slavery, for example, was universally acknowledged to be contrary to natural law. Animals, after all, are all born free. But civil law admitted slavery to be licit, and it's civil law which trumps universal law. So what Augustine is doing here in taking natural law, because it is the law authored by God, to be at once superior and universal, is a radical departure. I want you to also note the specificity of crimes against nature. Even the most heinous murder does not necessarily count as a crime against nature, unless it's one family member doing in another, especially a parent killing a child or vice versa. The horror characteristically evoked by unnatural acts in the Latin Christian tradition is correspondingly specific and has a partial, but only partial analog in Greek and Roman literary responses to sacrilege. And I think I can only give you just one example here. In the Euripides and Seneca versions of the Medea story, remember Medea, in order to revenge herself on her straying husband Jason, kills the kids. She kills both of her boys and displays them in triumph before her horrified husband after he's run off with another woman. In the Greek version and the Euripides version, this is certainly a very, very bad thing to do. And the words that Euripides uses and which the spectators in the play and Jason uses to describe it are words which are words of horror, but they have nothing to do with a violation of the natural order. It's a sacrilege. Similarly, Seneca, who reworks this story in the first century of the Common Era, also thinks it's a truly dreadful thing to do, but he calls it nefas. It's impious. It's a sacrilegious thing to do, not an unnatural thing to do. And this is all the more striking because in other parts of both plays, various characters do say that certain things are unnatural. So the chorus of the Corinthian women say in Euripides' Medea, well, now that men like Jason have broken their oaths, sworn before the gods, we might as well expect the rivers to run backwards. So there are appeals to the unnatural, but it's not killing your kids. Only in the Latin Christian tradition, when Medea is retold, does this act become the quintessential act of the unnatural mother. So I've chosen these two examples of norms derived from nature for maximum contrast, a positive ideal of justice versus a negative specter of horrific malfeasance, a philosophical argument from analogy versus a theological argument from divine sovereignty. Natural order understood as the harmony of specific natures versus the edicts of God the Creator. But I think in neither case are you likely to find these norms very compelling. On the contrary, I suspect that many of you will find them to be particularly repellent examples of the naturalistic fallacy of trying to transmute the is of nature into the ought of ethics. After all, Aristotle used the same argument about organic specialization to defend slavery, and the religious marginalization and even persecution of homosexuals as guilty of unnatural acts is, alas, still too timely to belabor. You might ask, aren't these sobering examples of exactly
why we should stop seeking norms in nature. And you might press the point. You might say, at best, nature's authority is borrowed, whether overtly from God or covertly from social convention, and therefore it's redundant, we don't need it. And at worst, it's a dangerous weapon in the arsenal of the most repressive and regressive elements of society. You may well second John Stuart Mill's view that invocations of nature are, as he wrote, the most copious source of bad taste, bad philosophy, bad morality, or even bad law. Or as the journalist Jessica Mitford put it rather more pithily, nature, nature, how I hate her. So I think it's quite legitimate to ask how these historical examples can in any way support the philosophical claim that nature is and should be a source of values. My argument is going to depend on a distinction between the content of these specific norms, or any specific norms, and a much more general claim about what philosopher Christine Korsgaard has called normativity. And what normativity is the justification that gives any and all norms their force. Now, it's a notorious fact that specific norms vary widely over cultures and over time. And this also appeals to those norms which are allegedly derived from nature, which can run the gamut from apartheid-style racism to Sierra Club-style environmentalism. But normativity itself is a far more uniform and durable phenomenon. There's no known human culture, either past or present, without norms, however diverse these may be in their specific incarnation. Now, I realize that normativity sounds like a word that's been badly translated from the German, one of those bloated abstractions that makes your mind go blank and your stomach growl. But it's really quite simple. It's just the quality of telling us what should be, as opposed to describing how things actually are. Now, of course, there are many mansions in the house of should, including the shoulds of how we should act, how we should know, and how we should admire, otherwise known as the good, the true, and the beautiful. What all these shoulds have in common is a certain wistful, counterfactual mood, a kind of subjunctive yearning, if only things were the way they should be. And since Hume, most modern philosophy has insisted on the counterfactual dimension of norms in morals, epistemology, and aesthetics. That is, a chasm is perceived to yawn between what is and what should be. We've all been taught to insist, as part of our intellectual training, on the distinction between is and ought. By the time Kant was writing about the realms of natural necessity and human freedom in the late 18th century, he could take the absolute distinction between the human realm of freedom and the natural realm of necessity for granted. I don't wish to call into question this distinction, which I think for analytical purposes can still be quite useful, but I do want to query the gap between them. There's at very least an interesting analogy between the two realms, which Kant himself eloquently expressed. He wrote, "Two things never fail to fill me with awe, the starry heavens above and the moral law within." Now, what awed Kant was the regularity exhibited by both the astronomical laws that governed the movements of the heavenly bodies, as well as the moral laws that governed the human conscience. The word law is used here in two different senses, but the justification for metaphorically and anthropomorphically extending the notion of human laws to laws of nature was precisely the stern regularity exhibited by both. The emotion of awe is as specific as the emotion of horror. If horror is the emotion which is evoked by the unnatural, awe is the emotion which is evoked as by the cosmic in both of its root senses, namely as an all-encompassing order and as an exquisitely designed ornament. Remember that cosmos is the root not only of cosmology but also of cosmetics. The recognition of an order is key to all kinds of norms. The vaster, the grander, the firmer the order, the stronger to its plane of that peculiar compound of wonder, fear, and respect known as awe. The German is a little more transparent. It's Ehrfurcht, which is literally a combination of reverence and fear. As Kant acknowledged, awe is a very rare response, but both natural and moral orders command it. Now, there's also a temporal dimension to this analogy between the moral and natural orders, which I'll return to in my conclusion. Here, I just want to stress the point that any order worthy of the name, whether social or natural, demands a temporal dimension that extends into the future. It's the order that links the past and the present to the future, the continuity that's the precondition for rationality and morality alike. And this is why social norms are honored, even though it's common knowledge that they are conventions, variable over histories and cultures. The ancient Greek historian Herodotus tells a story about the Persian king Darius, who performs the following experiment, anthropological experiment, at his court. And keep in mind that Herodotus himself is a cosmopolitan traveler and ethnographer. So he writes, "When Darius was king, he summoned the Greeks who were with him and asked them what price would persuade them to eat their father's dead bodies. They answered, there was no price for which they would do it. Then he summoned those Indians, who are called Kalatiae, who eat their parents, and asked them, the Greeks being present and understanding by interpretation what was said, what would make them willing to burn their fathers at death?" So that's what the Greeks do. "The Indians cried aloud that he should not speak of so horrid an act. So firmly rooted are these beliefs, and it is, I think, rightly said in Pindar's poem that custom is king of all." Now, custom is king. This later became the motto of those who wished to assert the multiplicity and relativity of social norms and moral standards against those who seek absolutes in both domains. But there's no evidence that Pindar, who coins this phrase, or Herodotus, who invoked it, meant to endorse relativism or indict custom as morally flimsy. Quite the contrary. Rather, Herodotus wants to emphasize the necessity of custom, regardless of its specific content, to create and sustain a social order. Nature without order is chaos. Society without order is anarchy. In states of chaos or anarchy, the past is no guide to present and future. There are no regularities, be they human promises or natural cycles, to support either justice or knowledge. Now, I don't want to burden this analogy with more weight than it can bear. It's an analogy, not an identity, nor do I have any stake whatsoever in which direction the causal arrow points. It probably points in both directions. I simply want to draw your attention to how this analogy continues to vibrate sympathetically across the gap which separates nature and the moral order in modern philosophy. Neither can do without the other. You may still, however, protest. You may protest, aren't all of these analogies just so much more evidence for the inveterate human tendency to project our own fantasies, in this case, fantasies about ideal social orders, onto nature? My response is that, for my purposes here, whether natural orders are projections or exemplifications of social orders, or most likely, I think, both, is completely beside the point. Let's assume, for the sake of argument, that they are projections. After all, there would be natural orders without human beings to infuse them with meaning. But we're still stuck with the question, why bother? Why duplicate the moral order with an analogical natural order? If human beings must construct a moral order for themselves, why turn to nature for your raw materials? I believe that the answer lies with the very nature of norms. Whatever it means to be a norm, a way things should be, depends on a concept of an order, regardless of the content of particular norms or the kind of order, human or natural. I think we're now in a better position to understand the inveterate habit which drives philosophers mad of conflating the prescriptive with the descriptive. And the word normal perfectly captures this confusion. It simultaneously means what does happen most of the time and what should happen most of the time. And we sometimes invoke it even when we're talking about natural catastrophes, so disruptions of the usual natural order. It's certainly futile to rage like King Lear against the wind or against Hurricane Katrina, but there's a kernel of philosophical sense in this psychological nonsense. Order per se defines the normative, even if we can reasonably argue about the desirability of this or that specific order. The way in which most people come to understand what an order is in the abstract is on hand from the concrete examples, both natural and social, that pattern their daily experience. Now, it may be provincial to mistake one's own familiar order for order tout court, but the intuition that order in general is intrinsically normative hits a deep truth. I'd now like to conclude with reposing the question, are we now in a position to reclaim norms from nature? And I think my answer is a qualified yes. First, the qualifications. I don't think the prospects of specific norms inspired by nature are much improved. Or rather, I see no reason to privilege them above norms of more purely human derivation. One reason is that nature exemplifies so many different kinds of orders. The order of the stars and the planets is not that of the weather. The order of specific natures is not that of universal natural laws. And the order of local ecologies with their distinctive flora and fauna is not that of the cosmological unities of gravitation. So nature is every bit as fertile in variety as culture is. The hope that norms extracted from nature will converge more convincingly than those freely invented by art is illusory. So this means that the strategy of naturalization to combat relativism is doomed. To certify that certain human values are natural, whether in the liberal cause of human rights or the conservative one of social Darwinism, does not lend them one iota more of certainty, universality, or permanence. Opponents can always retort which nature and counter with examples of another order equally natural. Yet the very variety of natural orders suggests why we can't do without them. Nature is a repository of all imaginable orders. That's why the word nature is so embarrassingly rich in definition. You might think of nature as a kind of Wunderkammer of all possible orders. Remember that the Wunderkammer were these primordial museum collections, often of Renaissance princes, in which you might have a floor-to-ceiling display in which a stuffed crocodile was juxtaposed next to a fly in amber, or a stuffed two-headed cat, magnets, and petrified wood. They're intended to overwhelm the spectator with the blooming, buzzing confusion, the glorious miscellany of it all. Now, although the Wunderkammer systematically favored the rare and singular over the commonplace and the ordinary, even everyday nature overflows with variety. The surprises of ethnography, fancy thinking that, pale beside those of natural history, fancy being that. All human dreams of order, revolutionary or reactionary, local or global, are ultimately figured, made vivid and alluring in nature's Wunderkammer of all possible orders. Order is not always a smiling word. It sometimes has a stern, steely ring to it, the snap of manacles, the clang of the prison door slamming shut. Polities that make law and order their motto are notoriously prone to cruelty and repression. But these dictatorial regimes take the name of order in vain. It's the essence of tyrannies and totalitarian governments to destroy the expectations of their unfortunate citizens. Everyone is kept in a state of fear by the unpredictable exercise of power at the whim of the ruler. Terror is wrought by violence combined with randomness, a very different shade of fear than that provoked by equally dangerous but more calculable risks. The very arbitrariness of dictators is their most loathed and effective weapon. No one knows when and why the Gestapo or the KGB or the Stasi will strike next. Kafka's inscrutable bureaucracies operate with the same deliberate caprice, by rules so complicated and opaque that they negate all regularity. One can never know whether tomorrow will be like today. These are not examples of order, but rather of institutionalized anarchy. It's chaos, the destruction of all order, that is the true unnatural. The unnatural consists not in violations of the will of God, however construed, but in the pathology of will known as the arbitrary, dictates and edicts based on nothing more than caprice, willing for the sake of willing alone. It is true that nature also seems sometimes capable of caprice, those freakish concatenations of causes that produce the odd monster or maelstrom. But nature's caprices are not only by definition rare, they are impersonal. Nature does not will. Nature cannot be arbitrary in the root sense of the word. People who have suffered under tyrannies report that one of the most dehumanizing aspects of such regimes is the element of humiliation implicit in being at the mercy of another's caprice, even if the outcome is only confusion rather than violence. The extreme case of being completely subject to the will of another is slavery, but all arbitrary decisions exercised by authorities injure human dignity. If the authority is personal, insult is added to injury. We become the victims of another's disdain as well as power. Nature's power to injure is immense. Witness the destruction of earthquakes, volcanoes, and tsunamis. But nature can never insult. Nature is inhuman, so much the better. Nature is not a person, nor the minister of a personal god or gods. Nature just is. But for just this reason, we humans cannot do without nature. Our needs go beyond the technologies of food, clothing, and shelter, the air we breathe, the water we drink. Nature also supplies the raw materials for meaning, even if nature by itself is meaningless. Because we are embodied organisms, we must incarnate our orders. We must find a way to display them to ourselves. We humans need to make meaning out of nature because nature is the fount of all order, or rather orders. This brings us back to the ghastly landscape of chaos. For the moment, it's immaterial whether the order has been shattered by an earthquake or by an invading army. It is certainly horrific, but wherein does the horror lie? Animals can feel terror, but only humans can feel horror. It's the emotion that registers a deep disruption of an order, no matter what kind. It can be evoked by a natural monster or a moral one, a two-headed baby or a mother who kills her baby. But horror can also be evoked by the destruction of time, a chaos so overwhelming that all bonds between what was and what will be are severed. There is only the present, the mental world to which brute beasts are forever confined. There is no longer the trust that cements human obligations, nor the predictability that guarantees natural regularities. The two great norms of truth and justice, what Kant epitomized with the starry heavens above and the moral law within, are annihilated together with time. This is the horror of chaos, which holds all orders at bay. Thank you for your attention.